The opposition is under attack for wanting to cut $500 million from the billions of government handouts we give to car makers. But are our handouts really saving jobs or just saving lazy managers and unions? Former union official Grace Collier, now of Industrial Relations Consultants, has checked the deal that Holden has with its unions, and she joins us now. Good to see you, Grace. Now, Holden sales are tanking, even though we've given it hundreds of millions of dollars and seems set to bail it out with 200 million more. Are our handouts saving Holden jobs or subsidising slackness?
Good morning, Andrew. Our money is subsidising slackness. The deal that Holden has made with its unions in 2004 certainly locks the company into high-cost arrangements that are totally inflexible, and they leave the company vulnerable because they're unable to adjust internal factors to respond to the pressures of external factors.
Well, look, you've checked that deal, and I'm just astonished. They're, meantime, giving wages, for example, way above the award and have pay rises of 5% each year every year.
That is totally correct. It's hardly appropriate for companies that are struggling and relying on government handouts to be giving pay rises and conditions far in excess of the award and what other people in the community get. But Andrew, it's important to understand that it's not just the money that we're talking about. One of the big problems with this agreement is the power that it hands to the union and the problems that that leaves management in.
I've had a look at some of these things that you've pointed out. Really, a company should be in a position to help itself. Instead, we've got the union saying, for example, that the company can only hire casuals with their approval. That strangles the business, doesn't it?
Absolutely. And not only can they only hire a casual with the union approval, the union gets to dictate how long the casual is hired for and what tasks they can do. And then after 3 months, the casual becomes permanent.
And they can only hire, Holden can only hire a labour hire business selected by the union. That doesn't sound quite rigid, Idge.
Well, that clause has been inserted in the agreement for one reason only, and that is because it allows the union to make an income stream from that. So, for instance, where you have agreements like this that allow unions to dictate the labour hire companies, the trade contractors, the insurance companies that hold and pay for the insurance premiums for, that allows the union to earn an income stream in excess of their normal membership dues.
It's just incredible to see how we're paying so Holden can have a feather bedding type of agreement with the unions that strangle its ability to become competitive. For example, now, voluntary redundancy there is so generous that workers can get typically $400,000.
Yes, that's correct. And what's really surprised me, Andrew, is that the Prime Minister described this industry as highly productive. I think that's extraordinary. As a former Labor lawyer, the Prime Minister really owes it to the community to read these enterprise agreements, which are only on the Fair Work Australia website. They're public knowledge. Anybody can look them up. She should read them, and then she should explain to the Australian community just exactly how these agreements are an example of a productive industry.
Let's not just pick on Holden. Toyota Australia also gets high subsidies. Its Australian manager complained that a third of his own workforce can take a sickie on some days. A third. I mean, why are we subsidising the jobs of workers who won't work or won't work in a way that makes the company competitive?
Quite simply, Andrew, international companies take this view. They have a view that if they are going to invest in Australia and have operations in Australia, then they need to be subsidised, and this is why. Their view is, we'll come and invest in your country, but if you're going to have all of these dreadful rules and terrible culture, then you have to pay for us to invest in your country. And we will then get the unions on board, share up the spoils with the unions, because we know that the unions will assist in pressuring the government to save the Australian jobs that are created.
Grace
so it's
Collier,
a deliberate
look,
strategy.
It seems to me we are feather-bedding inefficient companies, and thank you very much for helping to point that out. New Speaker Peter Slipper, the man with the huge expenses, is trying to control a parliament that doesn't respect him. Now, the opposition is still furious that he ratted on them, and Slipper has tried to ignore some muttered insults hurled at him in Question Time.
I've been around in politics long enough to know that you've got to have broad shoulders.
But Labor finds Slipper now biting the hand that fed him. He's been much tougher than former Speaker Harry Jenkins on Labor ministers who dodge answering hard questions, and particularly the Prime Minister.
The Prime Minister will be directly relevant.
Order tax
the
cuts
Prime
taken
Minister
away.
Family will ensure that her response is directly relevant.
Because
the
this
Prime
is
Minister
an opposition
will return to the substance of the question.
I will, Mr Speaker.
The
surplus,
Prime Minister
and it's
will
written
become
all
directly
over
relevant.
Tactics.
I would invite the Prime Minister to, shall we say, withdraw that reflection on the Deputy Leader of the Opposition.
Well, well, well. This could get very tense. And that's the show for this week. Please join our debate by sending me an email here at 10. And there's also my blog. Join us there. Stay with us. Meet the Press is next with Paul Bongiorno. I'm Andrew Bolt. Goodbye.